Hey, hello. How you doing?
All right, how you doing?
Good. Where to?
At the Big Apple.
Hey, you're in the Big Apple.
To Manhattan.
Hey, you're in Manhattan, too.
In New York. Want to go to New York.
You're still in New York. So far,
I want to go to New York City.
You're still in New York City. What do you want to do here?
I want to do the comedian, to be in show business.
What do you mean? You want to, like, tell jokes?
I want to tell the jokes.
Tell me some jokes?
Want to see some jokes?
Oh, yeah. I'd like to hear them, too. What?
My wife is cooking. It's so bad. It's terrible.
Yeah? That's it?
It's so much traffic. It took me an hour and a half to get here.
It's a long ride, right? That's
long.
Takes a long time.
Yeah.
Traffic. Expressway. Yeah.
Long time. Yeah. It took a long time.
A long time. But what, hour and a half or so, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
hour and a half to go to the traffic.
Sure. Hey, I get it. You're funny. This is, I got the perfect place.
My wife is cooking. It's bad. It's so bad. It's terrible.
See, I didn't get that the first time.
It makes me sick.
It's that bad. It's terrible.
It makes me sick.
Yeah, I understand. I got a good place for you. You know, I got a perfect place for you.
What is it?
It's called Catch a Rising Star. This guy David Brenner started there.
Anybody go on the stage?
Sure, anybody can.
Could I go on the stage and do my jokes?
Oh, they'd love to have you there. I could do it.
And I become a big star?
Big star. Amazingly big star.
Okay.
Yeah, we go up here, we make a right, we go through Jersey. It's a nice ride. Whole ride won't cost you more than $1,500. It's beautiful.
Yeah?
Yeah. You want to go there?
Yeah, I want to go in the big star, catch the big star.
You'll catch a big star there, believe me. You'll catch it.
Yeah.
We're on our way.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
My pleasure.
Catch a Rising Star's 10th anniversary special, starring Pat Benatar, David Brenner, Billy Crystal, Gabe Kaplan, Andy Kaufman, Joe Piscopo, Robin Williams, and introducing Rita Rudner, and me, I'm your host, Richard Belzer.
Thank you very much. I've never seen Philadelphia before. Thank you.
Whoa. What? You owe me some money.
But I don't have any money.
You don't have any money.
I don't have any money.
Jersey, you saw Philadelphia, the Liberty Bell.
I don't have any money, please. I don't have any money.
You
messed the paper, but I don't have any
money.
I'm sorry, but I did not know. I was just trying to get the money. You told me to take it out.
I know.
All I got was the money. I don't want to go to heaven.
This is the 10th anniversary of Catch a Rising Star, which is great for Catch a Rising Star and its owner, but for me it's rather depressing because it means that I've been doing this for 10 years and I've been doing it here for nothing. I started coming here in 1969 when it was Guido's First Avenue Pizza Parlor. It was terrific then. They had all the ovens on this side of the room, and they used to make the pizzas. It was a fabulous place. This is before Ketch opened up. And, you know, I used to come in. You know how guys make pizza. You ever notice a lot of Italian food is made by using parts of the body? Like pizza, they twirl around on their fists, wine, they step on the grapes with their feet, the bare feet. That's why I've never had an Italian donut. Anyway, I came here and I was in here and they closed it up. The pizza parlor closed. The next thing I knew, Catch a Rising Star opened. And I came in here and I'll tell you what happened. Rick, who owns the place, poured in, I understand, with some partners, $800 to $900. The people kept pouring in to hear from New York because, you know, New Yorkers, nothing stops them, right? If it snows, they come here. The garbage strike, they come here. At Christmas time, they were here during the garbage strike. Remember the garbage strike? What bothers New Yorkers? They look at a garbage strike Christmas. Oh, they were piling it up 20 feet high in the street. They're putting lights around it. Some people got very inventive during the garbage strike. If you don't know this, there was one man who flashed on 3rd Avenue three women through their garbage in. I have a friend, he got a bit of his garbage better than anyone. What he did, he took an old suit, he sewed up the pants and the sleeves, and he stuffed his garbage in it, and he got in a cab with it. He said, take me to Catch a Rising Star on 1st Avenue, 78th Street, and take him to 92nd and Madison. So they show up all the time. The main reason they show up is because of what you see here on the walls, you see. All the big names come here. Klein and John Belushi, may rest in peace, came here. Dustin Hoffman came here and discovered this fella, who was Big Richie Caron, who was the bouncer, bartender, MC, and is now a big movie star. Johnny Carson came here one night, and he discovered David Say. He saw him and put him on a Tonight Show. So a lot of the big names that came here. But there are also, we have to admit, not everybody makes it. On Monday night, there's what they call audition night or amateur night. It was a brilliant idea. I gave it to Rick, along with the French dip sandwich. I gave him both those ideas for nothing. But on Monday night, if you come here, we saw great acts. There was one girl who bared herself and said, if you connect the dots, it was Mick Jagger holding watermelons. Who knows what her head was like. We had one guy he sucked tennis balls. I don't want to get into it on the air. We had a fellow who showed us how he shaved. One night we had a guy come in here and he showed us he works for towing the cars away. He towed the piano off the stage, an insane person. We had a speed mind reader. No one understood what the hell he was saying. He was talking so fast. So there have been a lot of wacko acts, you know. But along with it, there's been the stars. And people come in to see the newcomers. As a matter of fact, tonight you're going to see a fellow who really epitomizes the club more than anyone. I've been coming here 10 years, but he's more than just coming here. He was the regular MC here. And he has a unique talent of being an MC under any conditions, but mainly he has a unique talent of being a guy who can work without a script, without material, and just work with whatever happens in the room, whatever happens to the audience. It's my pleasure to welcome a person I think is very talented, Richard Belzer.
Great to be in Catch a Rising Star, because I did start here. I auditioned here in 19... And Rick Newman said, babe, you know. That's all he said. He said, babe, you know. And no, he said, stick around. I said, what do I have to do? And the rest is history. But I have to admit something, and that is that I live in Hollywood now. And no, but if I lived there, then it's like it's okay. It's a rough adjustment, you know. California's my hand is caught in my hair. All right, I'm okay. Thank you for your concern. I'm okay because I go down a lot, but you know, yeah, sure, good. Anyway. But the most radical thing you have to adjust to in L.A. is earthquakes. Now, earthquakes are a serious thing. We don't have earthquakes here. You can't get out of an earthquake. You can't be in the middle of an earthquake and say, check, please. You can't do that. You have to stay for the entire earthquake. And my first earthquake experience was very sobering. It was very serious. I was in bed with my future ex-wife. And it was about 8 o'clock in the morning, and we were having sexual intercourse, and all of a sudden the bed started to shake a little more. And I figure, definitely gonna marry this bitch. I mean, this is great. You know. Then the room started to shake a little more, and I figured, I'm gonna marry this bitch for a long motherfucking time. Then the earth started shaking. I figure, hey, I'm the greatest piece of ass in the world. I'm balling this shit. The fucking planet is moving, okay? Until she said, honey, that was an earthquake. And I went, don't bring me down. Don't bring me down.
But I figured out what earthquakes are. Earthquake is God's way of going up to the earth. See, the earth is a ball suspended in space. And every once in a while, God comes by and grabs earth and says, cough. And everyone on the planet goes, there must be a God. You know what upsets me? You can laugh, it's show business, but you know, the thing that upsets me the most is that Ronald Reagan had to cancel his vacation. Don't you feel bad about that? I mean, he canceled his vacation. Here's the most sensitive man in America. I love Reagan's philosophy. I'm a millionaire, fuck you, okay? I can eat, take a fucking walk, all right? Food stamps, lick this, okay? Here's your food stamps right here. School lunches, eat fucking tree bark, okay? Vietnam vets, wrong war, keep marching, can't help you out, okay? Student loan, here, borrow this. Here's your student loan right here. Artists, create this, okay? Here's the artistic community, it's great. Unwed mothers, suck dick next time, all right? Reaganomics. Reaganomics, my ass, okay, babe? Fucking cowboy actor runs the country now, and we're supposed to sleep at night without drugs. I can't figure it out. How are you supposed to have a sound sleep with this guy, the president? What a great country we live in. But you know, no, when I first started in the business, I was a lot taller. But due to the constant touring, the drugs, the hotels, the motels, the women, the circus animals, it's taken valuable inches off my height. But you can help stop this dreaded disease by sending your dollars to, hey, I need the fucking money. Box 532-9168. That's, hey, I need the fucking money. Box 532-9168. Do you want to run and get a pencil? It's, hey, I need the fucking money. See, every comedian has a telethon, mine is me. Jerry Lewis is on television once a year for 22 hours. I think that's enough, don't you? Well. Okay, Jerry, great cause. Take a walk. All right, guys, thank you. There should be a telethon for what he has. Okay, Jerry, we're going to call the doctor. We'll get you cured in a second, babe. Let's cure his ass first, then we'll get to the other shit later. Yeah. Okay, Jerry, great. Help stamp out Jerry in your lifetime, okay? And I read in the paper today they're going to bring Roots back. It's great. Television, you know, whatever makes money, they bring it back. And I guess that's a premise, but, you know. But from watching Roots 1, I figured out why black people walk the way they do. The reason black people walk the way they do is because for hundreds of years, black people were denied the use of white bathrooms. That's how the walk evolved. Like a black guy go up to a white place, ask if he used the bathroom. Say, can I use the bathroom? No? God damn. Babe, why are you waiting so long? And do you ever notice that Mick Jagger is like, you know, he's watched black people for a long time. You ever see Jagger work? Jagger is like a rooster on acid. It's like... There's a young man who worked here a long time ago. Rick, how many years?
Eight.
Eight years ago, when I was just in my teens. And when I was, yeah. So anyway, this guy worked here with, he was in a comedy team. He was in a group. And then he went out on his own and became a single, as we say, in the industry. And he made a lot of noise because he was great alone. And then he started doing a lot of talk shows and variety shows, and eventually he was on soap. And then he had his own special show that was aired last year. And he's a fantastic performer, a good guy, a great comedian. Please welcome Billy Crystal, ladies and gentlemen.
The
Grateful Dead. Thank you, guys. See you later. Peace this year, huh? How is everybody? Is it hot in here, or is it me? You don't say, thank you. The breeze went downwind, huh? Some things never change, you know? I started here, and I'm still in the bar hoping I don't follow Brenner. Because everybody would leave. And then you hope you don't follow Lenny Schultz, because everybody was wet. Or Andy Kaufman, because everybody was pissed. You know? I'm glad to be back in New York. God, be back here. I used to play places. This was like Vegas to us, you know? Used to play places where every few minutes you'd hear this sound. Carmine Fortunato just bowled to 211 on Alley 22. Phone call for Rico Petrocelli. Pick it up, please. It's good to be back in New York. Walk around the streets. Hear some of the quaint New York City sounds. Move your fucking truck! Nice. I used to live in predominantly a black neighborhood when I was going to NYU when it was only $1,000 a credit. And I majored in quiche. And I live in this black neighborhood, which was great, especially on movie day. And especially if it was a scary film. Have you been to a scary film with an all-black audience? Oh, it's all the trip. It's more exciting. I mean, they get involved. They yell at the screen. That's what movies are supposed to be like. Remember seeing Jaws? Remember? You knew she was going to get eaten in the beginning. You just didn't know when. So everybody's tense, right? Come on in. The water's gone. Dun, 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 dun. Come on in. The water. Dun, dun, dun. It starts to get close. Everyone's getting real scared. Come on in. Dun, dun. It's getting close. Here it comes. Kelp is flying by. Come on in. Dun, dun, dun. Some guy can't stand the pressure. Stands up and yells, don't be taking no dip now. Go! See, that's why we don't swim. It's a bad fish, man. Yeah. So it's good. I'm seeing a lot of my old relatives, which is great fun. Be back here and see my relatives. They're all in their 80s now. It's nice, though. It's great to sit across the dinner table and ask me the same question. Billy. Who's on MIV? Billy, who's on MIV? Huh? Billy, who's on MIV? Huh? He walks around the house in his bathrobe. He waddles, got this cute smiley face. It's E.T. I phone home. I got a goddamn phone home after 11. It's cheaper. Ouch. So. Because my Uncle Louie, that when he eats, he should not be allowed to talk. He shows you everything in his mouth. I can't, and they always pick the right food. Billy, give me the sour cream. Good. So, I said to the guy, look, what the hell do I have to go to the goddamn bankroll? You know what I'm talking about? $1,000 for a toaster? Give me the coleslaw. I want to make this real disgusting. Thank you. So I said, look, what the hell? Moiv changed his name to The Moiv Show. Who the hell knows it? You know what I'm talking about? Huh? As a kid, I always collected baseball cards. Need 'em, got 'em, need 'em, got 'em. It's fascinating what's happening with the Yankees, you know. I went to Old Timers Day. It was so great. See, Mantle, DiMaggio. And then the Yankee Old Timers lose to the American League Old Timers. Steinbrenner trades Mantle and DiMaggio. I mean, what? What are we talking about? But I played sports in high school. I was a big basketball player in high school. And scoffing? I played at Long Beach High School, Long Beach, Long Island. Really? Now, we played a team, you lying to me. We played a team from Brooklyn, Erasmus Hall High from Brooklyn. Now, you have to understand, it's different kind of ball. In New York City, they play basketball. Hey, man, let's be playing some basketball. You want to play basketball? Let's play basketball. In Long Island, they play basketball. They were men. We were 12 Jewish kids with no hair on our balls, okay? We were very mature in the locker room before the game. Does the jocko on our nose or what? This can't be right. We look like a surgical team here. Two bam, three crack. You know? Now, they intimidate the hell out of us by the way they come to our high school. This is a high school team, right? They come to our high school, a Greyhound bus for the team. And another bus for the children of the team, okay? So we get out on the court, their fans organize. They got 1,000 fans, right? They organize right away into these very heavy, scary African chants. We run out, this is our home field, and we hear, Molebo, Belebo, Erasmus, Erasmus, kill them, kill them, kill them. And our cheerleaders on the other side going, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Hey, die, die, Yenu. Seniors only, die, die, Yenu. One for the building fund, die. All right? So now, third quarter comes, we're doing good. We're only down 55 points. And I'm sitting in my usual spot. And the coach turns to me and says something that really pisses me off. Billy, go in. Are you nuts? There's a game going on here. Now, I had shaved my head, you know, to look more intimidating, you know? I look like Henry from the cartoons, okay? I was like, you know how embarrassing it is? You go out on your home court, your fans are cheering you, you try to look tough, you tuck in your jersey, and your number disappears, okay? So now I'm guarding a building in four pairs of socks. This man's legs, his legs are so big as koala bears living on them. He's like... Now, he's coming up. I get down as low as I can, which is, like, redundant. And his knees are hitting me in the face. It's like... But you scrap it. It's not how big you are, man. You gotta have heart, right? I hit the ball. It rolls loose. I grab it. These two big hands grab it. And ref goes, jump ball! You! And you! Crowd laughs. I get to the foul line. I look up. I am looking right at this man's hip. I can't see his face. There's too much fog. And the ref throws up the ball, and then everything is like in slow motion. I don't hear another thing except my heart beating and like the Chariots of Fire music, you know? The ball is spinning in slow motion. I can read it. Void. And I get down like this, and I jump up as high as I can, close my eyes, reach up. Spot. He jumped too. He writes me. He's now with the Vienna Boys Choir. He's doing very well. But afterwards, people always say this. They say, you're unbelievable. It's great you did that. You know, you're an unbelievable class clown. What a class clown. You're an unbelievable class clown. The best goddamn unbelievable class clown in the world, right? I was not the class clown. I was the class comedian. And there's a big difference. The class clown was the guy... Well, like at the last football game, as seniors, freezing cold weather, right? He'd take off all of his clothes, put clothespins on his nipples, and run across the field, okay? That's a class clown. I was a class comedian. I was the guy who talked him into doing it, okay? And then sexually, I was nuts, because sex happens in high school. It's really crazy. You guys, you know, like around 15, you get that voice. Hello, how are you doing? Hi, how are you? Hello, hi. You get that little mustache, you know? You look like half the women in Newark, okay? Hi, how are you? No, I'm not Mario Procaccino. Hello, how are you? And then, I was always ready. I mean, sex first happens, forget about it. My glands were like yelling at me. It was like, now, 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 now. I was uncontrollable. I was a Geiger counter for skirts in high school. Like, now, 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 when? Soon, I hope. I can't stand it.
Me either.
It was... Now, I got a date with this girl. I was so blind with passion, I could not remember how to get to a house.
Make a left.
It was like... I get to the door, I hear something that scared the hell out of me.
Let me ring the bell. Forget it. I'll not.
It's a long way from self, isn't it? So now, door opens, greeted by her father, who's like totally boring. I mean, you know, hello, Billy, how are you doing? Ellen's upstairs, she'll be down in a second. How about a Coke?
That'd be great.
Forget it, where's the girl?
Coke is great, thank you very much. How you doing?
Why don't you sit down?
I can't. I'll just poke around the magazines here for a while, okay?
Forget it. I'm going upstairs.
Shut up. Don't talk to me. Hey, what are you doing?
Who are you talking to?
Nobody.
And then from out of nowhere comes the family dog. How do they know? They come in. Crotch! He's in love right away. You gotta...
This is great. He's really great.
Here's something scared the hell me.
Forget the girl. I want the dog.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Happy anniversary, Rick. Bye. Thank you.
Rock and roll! Ouch!
They're so quick.
And now we have a special treat, a young lady who actually started here. And Rick Newman saw her and said, okay. One of the smartest things he ever did. And we're very proud to present her tonight. Please welcome Chrysalis recording star, the one and only, Pat Benatar, ladies and gentlemen.
This is great.
Did you sleep with an Aztec pimp last night, or? Talk about Titicaca, babe. That's a lake. It's not a dirty thing. But now, we have a young man. He's still young. And you know, I'm sure you'll recognize him instantly, but let me give him a proper introduction because he's a good friend of mine. He's worked out here a lot, Catch a Rising Star. And he was the star of Welcome Back, Cotter. And he's done several films. He's worked in nightclubs all around the country. And he's a good friend of the room and a fantastic comedian. Please welcome Mr. Gabe Kaplan, ladies and gentlemen.
What a thrill it is to be here at the 10th anniversary of Catch a Rising Star. The place that has started so many young performers. And its owner, founder, Rick Newman, who's given encouragement unparalleled in the annals of show business. I remember the first night I came here to go on stage. I was nervous. I got on stage, I did my act, and I want to know how I did. I stood in the corner and I waited for Rick to say something to me. He came over and he said, "Kid, did you pay for that Coke you ordered?" My family still lives in Brooklyn. A word I used to hear all the time growing up in Brooklyn was Schwarzer. Schwarzer is a derogatory expression for a black person. Actually, Schwa in German and Yiddish means black. But it's used derogatorily. And I used to hear this word all the time. When I was young, I thought a Schwarzer was a bomb. Because from the way people talk, one Schwarzer could destroy an apartment house. And I lived in deadly fear of Schwarzers coming and destroying my apartment house. One day, a lady came into my apartment to tell my mother that a Schwarzer was coming to our building. Well, I put on my football helmet, some binoculars, and went downstairs to look for the planes. I didn't see any planes, but a van pulled up, and a black family got out and started moving into the building. Now, it was obvious to me that nobody had warned them about what was happening. So I went up to the father. I said, "Are you moving in here now?" He said, "Well, yes, we are." I said, "You're moving in at a bad time. There's a Schwarzer coming in." I remember I first did that routine right here in Catch a Rising Star. My first television show was a Johnny Carson show. That was my first national exposure. I was never exposed nationally before that. Once in a while, I did a little thing on a bus, you know, but... Actually, the first show I was on was The Dating Game. Now, that was my only television experience. And I was living in Miami at the time, and I just moved back to New York. And the building I was living in Miami, the people were old. The average age of the people in my building was deceased. I think if you're old and Jewish and the end is near, you hear a voice. Just like elephants hear a voice, old Jewish people hear a voice. Come to Miami. And I started to think, well, what would happen if they did The Dating Game from my apartment house on Miami Beach? And I worked this routine out here, and it was the first thing I did on the Johnny Carson show just about 10 years ago. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, from Miami Beach. It's time for The Dating Geriatric Game. Brought to you by the makers of Polident and Rock Candy. We have three widowers who'd like to meet our widow. We're going to bring them out now, and here they are. Widower number one was a pawnbroker. He's retired now. He says he has the only condominium in Miami with three balls in the front of his door. This is hobby, says gin, rummy, and Malox. Let's say hello to Mr. Saul Nazerman.
Hello, everybody. Nice to meet you.
Widower number two, at 81 years old, calls himself a physical fitness buff. His favorite expression is, if you don't use it, you'll lose it. Let's say hello to Mr. Max Tobias.
Hello, everybody. How are you? Maxie's here.
Thank you, number two.
If you don't use it, you'll lose it.
Thanks a lot. Number three was a waiter at a delicatessen in New York City for 40 years. Retired recently after 40 years of being a waiter, Mr. Irving Schwartz. You know what you want, or you want to see a menu? Everything is good today. I only got two hands. I'll be back in a minute. Thank you. And now let's meet our widow. Here she is returning to us from successful hip surgery at Mount Sinai Hospital. She's active and sports-minded. She likes shuffleboard and changing the batteries on her pacemaker. Sadie Feinberg. Hello, Sadie.
Hello, hello to you. Believe me, it's a pleasure to be here. Where am I?
Sadie, you can put your shopping bags down. This is the dating geriatric game, and your son Norman is in the audience.
Is he? Is he with his wife, the whore?
Sadie, we have three gentlemen. We're going to ask them to say hello to you. Number one, would you say hello to Sadie?
Hello, Sadie. Nice to meet you. Cool.
Number two, would you say hello to Sadie?
Sadie! I want to jump on your bones.
What does she want to do? That's all right, Sadie. Number three,
if you don't use it, you lose it.
Thank you, number two. Number three, would you say hello to Sadie? You know what you want, or you want to see a menu? Everything is good today. I only got two hands. I'll be back in a minute. Okay, Sadie, ask him some questions. Number two, where would you take me on a date?
I take you to my apartment. You don't use it, you lose it.
Thanks a lot.
Number three, where would you take me on a date?
Dates? Dates?
We don't have no dates. You want some nice prunes? We got prunes, jello, applesauce. No dates. Show me where it's written dates. No dates. Number three, this is not that kind of a date. This is a date to go out on. To go out. The takeout is the next counter. Go ahead, take out whatever you want. I only got two hands. Say, that's about it. You're going to have to make up your mind. It's going to have to be number two or number three. Number one passed away during the questioning. So who's it going to be?
I think I'll take number three. At least I'll get something to eat.
Okay, let's bring him out here now. Here's your dream date, an ex-waiter from New York City, Mr. Irving Schwartz. Come out here and meet Sadie. We're going to tell you about your date. You're both going to be flown to Johannesburg, South Africa. Where Dr. Christian Barnard will perform the organ transplant of your choice. Choice, where do you see choice? No choice, no substitution, just what's on the menu. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I have to tell you a little postscript to that story. I did that show, and everybody, Rick and everybody here at the club, went down to see me on the Johnny Carson show. And then we went out and had a little celebration afterwards. And the next day, I'd been a comedian for about 5-6 years already before I did that show. And I was waiting for someone to recognize me, because that's the routine I did, and that was the first time I was on television. And the next day, I was walking along 59th Street. And this little old lady walked up to me.
Wait a minute. I saw you on the Johnny Carson show last night. I want to tell you something. You're going to be old someday yourself, you son of a bitch.
Thanks a lot.
Great to see you. Nice to see you, Richard. How are you? How are you?
Now?
You look wonderful.
If I died now, it would be great.
This club is a class joint. And it's nice to see you. I thought maybe I'd do a little something, if that's okay with you.
How about, should Frank sing a song? What do you think? God bless you.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you. You're wonderful. Now, as I understand it, there's a lot of young-type modern music played on this stage here. Now, I dig rock and roll, but there's only one way to do it. My way.
Saw her dancing now by the record machine. She could not have been more than 17. Played my favorite tune. I knew pretty soon that broad, she would dance with me. Yeah, me. I love rock and roll. Put a dime in the jukebox, baby. Dig that rock and roll. Sacrifice our love. You do not take advice. Someday you'll pay that tab, I know. You are chilly, baby. Yeah. Under my thumb. That gal, she shot me down. My thumb, that chick, pushed me around. It's down to me, Jack. The difference in the thread she wears, down to me. Change has come, thumb. So hit me with your best shot. Hit me with that shot. Hit me with your best shot. Fire away.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor that I pay tribute to a marvelous human being, one groovy cat, Bruce Springsteen. The highways jammed with broken heroes on a last chance power drive. Someone's on the run tonight. There is not one place to hide. Someday, girl, I do not know when we'll get to that place, or you and me. Take a stroll in the sun. Yeah, 'cause let me tell you, baby, tramps like us, sweetheart, born to run. That lady's a tramp, she was born to run. Let's go, baby, yeah. I love rock and roll. Stick some coin in the jukebox. I know what boys like. I know what guys want. They want to jump your bones, baby. Float on the water. Fire in the skies. Ouch. This is not a party. Ain't no disco. I'm no fooling around. No mud club, no CBGB. Do not have time for that now. got time to split into the bar at Catch a Rising Star. That's where the hip cats are.
Surprise! What a guy! What security! What a toupee! Oh, Mr. Sinatra's not offended by that. I live so recklessly. One of the things that makes this club as great as it is the fact that we are. Well, our name is Rising Star, Catch a Rising Star. And our next young lady is, she was on Broadway last year in Annie, and she's a stand-up comic now. And it's always a delight when woman, you know, when a lady does stand-up comedy because it's traditionally a man's field, and when a woman doesn't, she's good at it, we're delighted and we welcome it. So this young lady is very talented. She started here, and she works here a lot. And give her a warm welcome and your attention, please. Rita Rudner, ladies and gentlemen. Rita.
Thank you, Richard and boys. Thank you very much. As Richard was saying, I was on Broadway last year in Annie. I played the prostitute. I did. A few years before that, I was in the magic show. Maybe you caught that. Yes, thank you. I played the prostitute. I don't know why I'm always playing prostitutes. I really don't. In high school, I was voted the girl most likely to become a nun. That may not be very impressive to you now, but it was quite an accomplishment at the Hebrew Academy. I didn't start out to be an actress, though. I started out, I was a ballerina. To me, ballerinas are a brave bunch of girls. This is mean to say, but I'm going to say it. It's true. How many women do you know would run and just go leap into the arms of a homosexual and trust he's going to catch her? I come from a typical middle-class Jewish family. We were very wealthy. We weren't real religious. We belonged to the Beth Israel Temple and Yacht Club. I'm an only child. My parents play backgammon. For very high stakes, I used to have a brother. There's really only one way to describe my mother. There's a very old saying, I don't know if you've heard it, neurotics build castles in the air and psychotics live in them. My mother cleans them. She used to exaggerate a great deal. She used to tell me things like she had natural childbirth. I recently found out that's her own version of natural childbirth. She took off her makeup. Really amazes me, though, about having babies these days is that doctors can tell so much about babies while they're still inside you. They can. My girlfriend's pregnant, and I swear she had these tests run. It seems the baby is normal, and it's a boy, and it's a lawyer. It's going to be a long time for me for children. I'm very single. I was going with someone for a few years, but we broke up. It's one of those things. He wanted to get married, and I didn't want him to. I felt it would hurt what we had. We had a lot of problems. His mother didn't like me. You know why? It's not fair. She didn't like me because I'm in show business. And, you know, she thought I was very wild. And I don't know why people think women in show business are wild. The closest I've ever come to even a menage a trois is once I was dating a schizophrenic. I don't even understand how group sex works. I really don't. What did they say afterwards? You know, excuse me, was it good for anybody? I was reading, men reach your sexual peak at 18. This is true. Women reach your sexual peak at 35. Do you get the feeling that if there is a God, he's into practical jokes? I really like being a woman, though. There's one time in my life I think I want to be a man, though, during menopause. I'm scared, and it's not fair, because female menopause, you gain weight, you get hot flashes, you have nervous breakdowns. In a male menopause, you date pretty young girls and drive motorcycles. Anyway, you guys are very nice, and I'm going to go home now, which is a treat, really, because I've been on the road a little bit, and I was staying in Howard Johnson's, which is a very nice place, but have you heard their new slogan? If it's not your mother, it must be Howard Johnson's. So that's their new slogan, really. I thought it was just like a slogan, you know, but I was staying there. I called down for room service like 4 in the afternoon. I was very hungry. They said, no, it'll spoil your dinner. May came in every morning. She said, clean up your room. I was checking out, the lady behind the desk said, go ahead, leave, doesn't matter, I'll be dead in a couple of weeks. Thank you very much. Good night.
Hello, saludos, my friends. It is I, Fernando Lamas, here in Kasha Rising Star. Once I had to finish with do something funny in color. I think for you it'll be better, okay?
Ethel Waters has that.
Work on it.
Oh, okay.
Good to see you again. You want to play the clarinet?
Later. We'll
good.
Talk later.
Good. Good. Good to see you.
Let this be seen.
Good.
Fernando, that's so boring.
That's
so boring.
To me, I tell you something. That Robert De Niro is such an incredible man.
Did you see Bobby?
Bobby? That was Bobby, wasn't it?
No, that is Woody Allen.
Oh, forgive me. I tell you something. I don't know this thing. Look at him.
My friends are on this man. You must understand who is this man with Fernando. This is Carlos. For 5 years was my standing when we made.
He and I are like this.
We are. Which one is me?
Well, I love you so much. I love what you stand for, even when you're sitting.
Thank you very much.
You know something? I tell you something. You, as an actor, are far. You surprise yourself.
I do surprise myself just by looking at myself.
I said you surprise yourself, but you said surprise. Both. You surprise me.
Two surprises?
Maybe make Quinella. Like, that's the woman you worked with in your first film. Remember,
Roberta? Three and five, usually.
Yes, but the times.
But you know, we did so many pictures together.
Remember this? We did the Night of the Living Moths.
That was very good. I was good in that.
We did Killer Wool.
Rio Bamisfer.
Rio Bamisfer, which was you. You as the Delming Dancing Rabbi. I thought you, when you rode off into the sunset and sang Baruch Ator.
Good. I had the opportunity. I rode into town on the beautiful horse, and I said, you're a peon. And I remember I walked into town on the horse, and I said, look, here's some mud, go finish your house. You remember that?
It was adobe. Adobe. Yes, and I had only one line that day.
What was what?
Si.
Si. But you did it so marvelously well.
I did this. I felt it.
You look marvelous.
I tell you something. You look more than marvelous. You look superb.
I do look superb.
You look more than superb. You look magnificent.
I wish Esther.
How is Esther? How is she?
She does not look superb.
Well, but you shoot her from above. Look better.
Well, she's so far now, we have to shoot her on an aerial photograph to get it all in.
Fantastic. Okay. We have a young man on now who is a major star in the industry, as we say, and he worked here many years ago. I met him, I don't want to say how old we are, but when the club first started, we worked together, and he's a good friend of mine, so it's nice to introduce him. Andy Kaufman! Yeah.
Thank you. I came here 10 years ago, and I auditioned here almost exactly 10 years ago. I came in here and I went right on the stage and I started telling all these jokes with a foreign accent, and All the people who worked here in the whole audience, everybody was just going, oh, no, this is terrible. This man just got off the boat, and he's going to starve if he thinks he's going to do this for a living. And then all of a sudden, I turned around, and I came, and I turned into my Elvis Presley costume, and I turned around and did my Elvis Presley impression. Everyone went, whoa, you mean he was putting us on? Anyway, tonight, what I'd like to do is I'd like to do that exact same routine, which I did 10 years ago. It's called Foreign Man Turning into Elvis Presley. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I am very happy to be here. But one thing I don't like about New York
is the traffic.
Is too much traffic.
Too much traffic, that's right.
You know, tonight it was so much traffic.
It took me an hour.
I came on the highway, on the Long Island Expressway.
That way.
And it was so much traffic, it took me an hour and a half to get here. But talking about the terrible things,
take my wife.
My wife.
Her is my wife, please take her.
Take my wife, please take her.
Her cooking is so bad.
But no, really, I love my wife very much. But she don't know how to cook.
Her cooking is so bad, it's terrible.
One night she makes steak and mashed potato. And the night before that, spaghetti and meatballs.
See?
Her cooking is so bad.
It's terrible. It's terrible.
It's terrible. Now I would like to do for you some imitations. Some imitations. First, I would like to do for you the Ed Sullivan.
Oh, no, the Archie Bunker. So, the Archie Bunker you could do first. The Archie Bunker.
I would...
Yeah, sure.
Okay, first, I would like to do for you the Archie Bunker.
That's right.
You meet it. Get out of my chair.
You dingbat, get into the kitchen and make me the food.
You think? Dingbat, you dingbat.
You make go into the kitchen, make me
go
the
into
food.
The kitchen and make me the food.
Why is everybody so stupid?
Everybody's so stupid. I don't like anybody so
stupid. I want to do something new, then I'll be calling. Okay, so now you start. Go ahead. No, there's no problem. The only problem is that I'm doing your act for you.
Yeah. Why don't you just... Why? Is there a problem?
No, there's no problem. If you did some new material, then I wouldn't know what you're going to do next.
Well, I was asked to do this material tonight, okay? This is what the club asked me to do, and I'm doing it.
Sure, they asked you to do it because your new stuff's a bunch of crap.
I have a lot of new stuff that I could do.
Okay, do something new for us. Fine, I'll shut up. Do something new.
This is the act I did 10 years ago. Since then, I've been doing a lot of different things. I've been wrestling women, playing conga drums. You know, there's a lot of stuff that I've been doing.
Can I say something? I might have a few here, but I've was always a big fan of yours.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm talking 7-8 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I just feel that you have been repeating yourself continually.
I don't think so.
I don't consider wrestling women to be funny, to be creative,
mm-hmm.
to be any of those things, or, you know, and maybe you're going on Fridays. I don't know, they put you on Fridays.
I do a lot of late night, a lot of original stuff on late night, when I'm on late night.
Okay, so what? What's original? You don't do anything.
Well, on Fridays, did you see me on Fridays?
I saw you on Fridays.
About 2 years ago, caused a lot of talk.
Yeah, a put-on, pushing people around and actors going, people like don't know what the act, so you do something, you work it out and the actors don't know what's going on, but that's mm-hmm. nothing, that's not original, that's not comedy. That's put-ons. Anybody could do that. That's a put-on. You understand
yeah,
what I'm
right.
saying?
Yeah, right. It was a put-on. It made
honest,
the papers.
If I may.
It caused a lot of excitement. People are talking about, is it real? Is it not real?
But who gives a shit? I don't give a shit if it's real or not. I'm not trying to be obnoxious. I'm really not. I'm just saying, I'm just saying that you were a very original guy.
Yeah.
And
I was a very original guy. I was considered a very original guy.
And was is the key word right there. You said it yourself. Well, that's you've lost all credibility. All you're doing now, I'm going to be honest, I don't care. They could film this thing or do whatever they want with it. But I'm just saying, they'll probably cut it out anyway. But I'm just saying that you used to be an original performer.
Right,
see,
right.
You're just putting on people.
Still
it's put on. Nobody
uh-huh.
believes that anymore. More.
Uh-huh.
That's like some
well, I must be doing something right if I'm invited on all these late night shows. Okay?
And no, okay. Hey. Fuck you. Fine. My name's not Matt. Oh, I'm telling them, the only reason they put you on late night. That's your problem. You know, the only reason.
Okay, wait.
Let me just say my piece, okay? Because I'll leave. Because I've been sitting here sweating my ass. Fine. All right. Let me just say one thing, and then okay. Hey, look. Can I just say something?
What?
The only reason. And I'll settle with you in a second. Let me just say this to this jerk fool. The only reason they put you.
Yeah.
The only reason you're on Fridays and Saturdays.
That's right.
You know why? Because you do that stupid character Latka on Taxi, and that's why. If Taxi goes off the air, what are you possibly going to do?
There's a lot of things I could be doing.
You can't do movies?
Why not?
Come on, the movie, last movie you made, what was that, Heartbeat?
Yeah.
That's a piece of shit. That was a bomb.
That was not my fault. It was the directing, the studio, the writing.
Fine.
That was not my fault.
Andy Kaufman.
What?
Andy Kaufman, may I say something, please? The average viewer, the average schmo who goes to movies, who doesn't know anything about the business, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They don't know anything about directing or the writers. They see your name up there, man. They go see the movie. The movie stinks. Kaufman sucks eggs. That's it.
So I can do another movie.
No, you're not. They're not going to... Any offers? You got any offers lined up?
No.
Okay, what are you going to do? You got no act. You're going to do
I have a nightclub act.
Fine, then do some new material.
I have other... Mighty Mouse, Pop Goes the Weasel, or McDonald. Okay. Okay, those are all different things than what I'm doing tonight.
I'm saying new. Do something new.
How about Elvis?
Elvis is there. Elvis... You know, he's living the past. You can't even do Elvis. He's got to put on a wig now because he's losing his hair. So he has to do Elvis. Well, you must have been out of the country, honey, because everybody else saw it.
I have a lot. I was going to do Elvis.
Do
I will still
new.
Do Elvis.
I
would like to do some new material.
I apologize.
Okay?
If I
do material, new material, will you keep quiet?
Yes.
Just let me do my act? Okay?
I will.
All right. I'm going to do some new material. Okay, just give me a... I didn't prepare anything, but... No, I didn't, but I'll just...
Okay, do it. We're waiting.
Okay. I will do something new for you. Just give me a minute.
1 minute. We'll give you 1 minute.
Okay, let me concentrate. No. I'll do the twist. Okay? I can do the twist.
Honestly, be honest. Do something new.
I can do
the
twist.
I dare you to do something new, Kaufman.
Doing the twist and singing. Okay?
Anybody could do that. Do something funny. I mean, these people you see all night here that don't hear, they have material written, they hone it in,
they seem to be enjoying it.
Who?
The people. Okay, let me just think of it.
Because they know you from Taxi, you schmuck. Do some new shtick, not old shtick. Come on, do something new. We're waiting. I'm waiting.
Okay,
That's all. Be quiet. Let him do something new. Come on.
I guess you're right. I don't have any new material. I don't have anything new to do.
Elvis. Good. I rest my case then. I rest
Elvis.
My case. Say, that's old. That's old. What? He doesn't have anything new.
I don't have anything new. You know, I was trying.
This is the old crying routine, Bobby.
I thought I would do my best.
I just came here from my room. To do all the old things.
I do all the old things.
I thought you were my friend.
And I thought you were my friend.
I don't want to go.
I don't want to go.
It's old. That's my point.
What?
That's my point.
You what? You've seen me do that?
Yes, everybody's seen you do that.
What?
Kaufman, look, call a spade a spade. You don't have anything new to do.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, that is why he hired me tonight to come here. Sit here.
Look, there's a little mic on me. You see this?
He hired me tonight to come here and criticize him, you know, and he's saying, well, see, today's mood of what we're going to do, I'll take my old material, I'll call it variation on the theme. I mean, he thinks like he's a composer or something. I'm the variation is the theme is the old material, and the variation is that I'm told to sit here and criticize. Well, it's true. Am I being honest? Am I a plant? Be honest, am I a plant? Come on. Am I a plant? Is this another Kaufman put on? Is this more bullshit? Am I a plant? Be honest, is it a plant? Am I a plant? Tell the people, there's a mic here. Come on, you see it? Do you see it?
Yeah.
I'm sitting there as a mic. They sat me here before.
Yeah.
Now somebody pulled something on Kaufman, didn't he? Fine, then they just cut it out.
You just fucked up the act.
Fine. Fuck you! Fuck!
Are everybody ready? Is everybody ready? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, right now I'd like to do my oldest routine, which I've done so much times, there are many people that are sick of it. This routine, but I'm going to do it anyway. And it's my imitation of Elvis Presley. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Home to the party in the county jail. When the band was there, little band of wet. They were jumping down, they jumped again to swing. Should have heard them knocked out, jam, but sing a dance around.
You know your memory is gone.
Maybe.
All right. I discovered Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
I took some friends out.
I'm the guy that auditions people.
You audition, okay? And I told you to let her sing another song.
Yeah.
I said,
you're the one that said to do show tunes. I said, Rick, you're nuts.
You know, I can't believe you.
Yeah.
All right. I started Pat Benatar off in a singing career.
Where'd you come
want
from?
To take a falling. I discovered him. I discovered you. This place.
What are you,
I
Lewis
discovered
and Clark?
This place. You discovered
the wheel. Right?
You discovered overcoat.
Gentlemen, I discovered Pat Benatar years ago in a bank.
Yeah.
Started dating.
Why don't you go make an eccentric movie that only you understand?
Will you go right there? Yeah, right.
Get out of here.
Thank you.
you like
tomorrow.
The way she looks, I like the way she's saying.
What are you talking about? I can't believe that you're doing this.
I'm talking about. I discovered Pat Benatar.
Okay.
Can I get a pink lady bartender?
Oh, I'm sorry. You guys on? Sorry, did I ruin the tape for you?
No, not at all.
What were we talking about?
Pat Benatar.
Yeah. I was telling him how I discovered.
Who is he?
Pat Benatar.
Yeah, not Nat.
I was saying that I found her here one night. She came
in. Did she ever mention me anymore? Because, you know, I am really solely responsible for her career.
Oh, yeah?
This isn't very well known. We were in high school together in Nebraska, and I got her to change her.
She's considerably younger than you, babe.
She appears that way.
Oh.
If it's a good-looking Gentile girl,
Get out of here, Fellini, will you?
Wait a minute. No, Pat and I were in high school together.
Are you still on in the morning, Jerry?
She was what used to be known as the town clown.
The town clown.
You discovered
her in Nebraska?
Yes.
You and Marlon Brando, I'm sure.
Out of work trollop, and uh-huh. I got her a job. She came out from behind the Texaco station and went right to the top.
There's only one way to discover if you discover her, and that's what was she singing when you discovered her?
Quanta la gusta.
You discovered her. All right.
See?
Your card. Bartender. For the rest of my life. What an act. But you know, we're having a great time here tonight, aren't we all? Is your champagne still cold? It's great. Just keep me posted, babe. And by babe, I mean babe.
You're not dealing with it in a very radical way.
Well, I'm doing it in a New York way, and you're doing it LA man. Come here, babe. Interpret for me. Can show affection.
Real men can grab each other and say, call me.
Ladies and gentlemen, of course, you recognize Pam Dauber. Pam Dauber. Yeah. Outer space.
Looks
my
like
dick.
Before, yeah. After.
Right. Well, I'm New York man, you're LA man.
Well, for sure, this is like
could
a
you,
bit.
Could you interpret for me?
Well, for okay. sure, totally.
This guy from New York looking for transportation in LA. Can I get a fucking cab over here or what?
Excuse me, is there like any means of motivation anywhere for a brief moment?
Where can I buy a fucking steak over here, huh?
Well, is there like any decaying flesh that might satisfy me now?
L.A. man, you better lose your head.
For sure. Well, just look out there. Wow, okay. Yeah. L.A. man in New York going, wow, this is great. Should I go fuck myself now?
Or what time is it? Okay. And now, ladies and gentlemen, every film. This is every film that Peter Lorre and Humphrey Bogart ever did.
Oh, we turn around again?
Yeah. Yes, I remember the night.
I didn't want to do the jumps with him. I had to wear the silly clothes.
He always got Lorne because her voice was as deep as his. I had to. I never got to hold any balls. He got to hold balls. I never did. He was doing all the strange things. I had to make the faces. He tore my shirt. No one ever called me. He was wonderful. No one looked at his lips. I had to just sit there and mumble all the fucking time. I don't need this pressure.
Richard Belzer's next movie, Altered Suits, a Jewish man takes acid and buys retail.
And now this is all the Marx Brothers films in 2 minutes.
Hey, Dusty.
Turn around again?
Yeah.
I mean, hey, Dusty, you like the drugs, huh? Yeah, you like to smoke the pot, huh? What does the pot do? Yeah, make you hungry, right? Yeah, and then you do the quaalude, right? What do you want to do on the quaalude? Yeah, you want to have pot, right? All right, you get it up on the quaalude, huh? How about you want to ride the horse? No, the heroin wouldn't make it go down, right? Yeah, I know that. How about the cocaine? What do you do? Oh, yeah, that's no way, right? Robin Williams, ladies and gentlemen.
Nice to be back in New York on a hot day again. Seeing people instead of radios carrying large air conditioners going, how you doing? Is that a radio now? Fuck, it's an air conditioner, man. I have some bad news for you. While you've been here this evening, groups of gay men have broken into your apartment and redecorated it. I am a guardian comedian. If somebody is on the subway and flashes you, simply go,
I don't do miniatures.
That should mess him up for a while. That also doubles as like a Beverly Hills Boy Scout.
Will there be dry cleaning in the wilderness?
Yes, come on. Like some sort of firefighter. Come in low. Don't be afraid. Come in low. Every man here, though, knows. Did you see the Holmes-Cooney fight and the shot that was felt around the world? That one punch for everybody. Every man in the world went, oh, damn, Jack. Oh. At one point, he went up like a microphone in the corner. When, like, Larry Holmes came back to the corner going, I'm gonna nail that motherfucker. If I ever get my balls back down here, I'm gonna hit him in the head. The next day, they had Don King come on going like, yes, Howard. Howard, how does he get his hair like that? It's like, whoa, Mr. Benny, I ain't going in there. Whoa! He comes and says, yes, Howard, Jerry Cooney hit Larry Holmes in the testicles. Oh, I didn't know I had those. Yeah, they're testicles. You ever look at Don King, though, and think that he might be Buckwheat's illegitimate child?
Comedy for the people in East Germany. Keep singing! Only a day! Amontillado!
Rudy Belly on acid. Come on now, you guys, do the things you do.
Look at this.
Oh, Rick has some books here, wonderful books. Look at this one, Gary Coleman, The Early Years.
Back
here. Whoa. I can't get to the toys. What do those people do? Do the Krishnas go to a barber and say, yeah, just leave a little on the top?
Right now, the sound man's my hand. Oh, you need one mic, you're dead shit.
Oh, look, wait. We can do this one. Move back to the microphone again. There's a cameraman going.
Yeah, follow me now.
New York rat. Hi, Gordon Liddy for Bic Lighters. First time, every time.
Hello. Wine.
Yeah. So hard the series is over. I should be in some bar down in the Bowery going, remember me?
Ninny, ninny.
Yeah. The series ended, it was so hard to go around going, pardon me? Can you spare $40,000 a week? There's always somebody looking at you, oh, I ain't life a bit. I love when they taste the very elite wines, the fufuse or the pussy fussy, as we call it. They have some go, absurd yet flaccid, okay. You realize, they say that sports are being overrun by drugs. I finally realized that I went to the baseball park. There's a little guy going, Quaalude! Quaalude! Make a slow game go slower! No, I feel like those Broadway dancers.
Move, let's change the scene right now. It's another number. Let's go.
How are you doing?
You
have a lovely blouse on, and I can see down at you.
All right, how are you?
Oh, no! They didn't pay the bills!
I should be relaxing now, so it's okay. I should relax for a brief moment.
Somewhere. For me? You're not afraid of the sores, the big...
You're a lovely woman.
Aye, one more sip. Ah, Perrier. Somewhere in the Hamptons right now, some people are going, my God, we've run out again. Oh, shit, we might die. Tom, Biffy, Muffy, let's bring the other people in. How are you? Oh, my God, a Negro. Let's ask him something. How are you? You know, we got tired of buying Lacoste shirts, so we just stapled a live alligator to the house.
Those people are so damn wealthy, they don't get the crabs, they get the lobsters.
Oh, damn, I'm going to just cook them up. Help,
Just drinking again. I should drink some more, if you will.
This strange.
A little bug in there. Little bug died in Perrier going,
all these bubbles, I don't know.
You used to have sorry. Maybe the inquirer's right. Maybe I'm falling down. I'm having a nervous breakdown. Bullshit, I'm not. I'm okay. I'm fine. I'm fine. I'm fucking fine. Strange thing, I love the Inquirer. I do. I also like wearing fiberglass underwear sometimes. It's a wonderful magazine. Strange, I put a copy of the Inquirer in my cat box and the cat won't shit in there. Just looks up at me and goes, why? That'd be redundant. Looking around like, can't be things to play with.
All over here. Look, all sorts of things. A sign, a book.
Oh my God, Jimmy Hoffman. Rick, sorry. And now I'd like to do some ventriloquism for you, a very interesting act for you. People ask me, why do I touch myself? Because it's there.
Like that, once in a while.
Taking a picture, please.
Just pan back, dolly back now. Pan back, double back to the man's shirt. Focus on the nipple for a second.
Do it like a Mazursky film. Pan to somebody in the back, please.
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
Music time?
Thank you. I'd like to do something very, very special for you right now. I'd like to sing the theme song from Alien. I hope you enjoy this. I want to see Donny Osmond play Othello. Desdemona, don't be so weird. Or Nicholson play Hamlet. Be like, to be or not to goddamn be.
I don't know. I was going to be an actor. I always wanted to play Hamlet, have a small skull in my hand going, alas, poor Yorick, strike. This is the famous impression, well, the act that almost killed me. This is Elmer Fudd. Sings Bruce Springsteen.
I'm driving in my car. I turn on the radio. I pull you a little closer. You say no. You say you don't like it. I say you're a liar. But when we get, it's like fire.
Thank you all very much. Thank you, Mr. Newman. The ambition. Thank you. Good night.
Fantastic. What a night.
Joe Piscopo, ladies and gentlemen.
Joe Piscopo.
How about that chairman of the board impression, ladies and gentlemen?
Thanks.
There's a couple guys waiting for you outside.
Okay, that's...
I wish I was kidding. But I'll cover for you. I'll let you explain the routine, but they're pretty big, and good luck in your next incarnation.
Folks, I just wanted to come up and say hi, and thank you for being so nice, and congratulations to Rick Newman and Rich Fields on Catch's 10th anniversary. Thank you for being so nice. I'll see you again. Good night, everybody.
This has been a great night, don't you agree? Yeah. We had a great time? That's what it's all about here. We appreciate you coming. I'm glad you had a good time. Come back anytime. Every 10 years, you're invited, okay? It's been a great show. The performers all feel great. I'm glad you feel great. thank you very much once again. Have a good night. Drive safely, and we'll see you. Thank you. And congratulations to HBO on their 10th anniversary. Thank you.